4, he woke you up this morning. 5, he woke you up this morning. Started you on your way. Gave you a reasonable portion of help this trip. You don't even look like what you've been through. So somebody should give God a show of praise in this place. Deacon Ministry is now coming.
Johnny P. Pitts is in Rush Presbyterian Hospital, Chicago. Amen. We want to keep those in the hospital in our prayers because we know that God is still a healer. Amen. Amen. And while we're praying for those in the hospital, we'll continue to pray for those that are sick and shut in. Irma Ingram, Shirley Kelly, and Sylvia Block. Amen. Amen. It's still Clergy Appreciation Month. Amen, amen. As well as thank you everyone that participated with Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Amen. Amen. I can put this shirt back in the closet until next year. Amen.
Hey, good morning, Rock of Ages. Revival time is coming around again. Amen. Revival begins Monday, November 13th at 7 o'clock. Our guest speaker would be that of Pastor Tolan Morgan of the Fellowship Bible Baptist Church of Warner Roberts, Georgia. So we ask that you all put that on your calendars again. Monday, November 13th at 7 p.m. for fall revival. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Help me welcome our online viewers. We're grateful that technology afforded them the capability to view in with us here on Sunday morning. So I pray that God would enable them to come visit with us one Sunday here at the Rock. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If you're a first time or returning visitor, we ask you to stand at this time, not to embarrass you. We just like to properly welcome you to this place. First time or returning visitor. Good morning. Good morning to you. Good morning on behalf of our pastor, Pastor Marvin E. Wiley, the entire Rock of Ages Baptist Church family, and the official staff. We want to say thank you for coming to worship with us this morning. You could have chosen to go anywhere, but you've chosen to worship with us this morning. We're extremely grateful. So our prayer is that something be said or done that will inspire you throughout the rest of your week that makes you come back and worship with us again. But if you're looking for a church home, guess what? You just found it. There's no greater place than the Rock of Ages Baptist Church. Amen? Rock of Ages, tell me a word with our guests at this time. Amen. As our sister Yvette comes back, the next speaking words that you will hear be that of Pastor Marvin E. Wiley. Amen?
I love
morning. Give yourselves a break one more time. That was good. Sing this little bit of song that I want to sing. And it says, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There is something about that name. Some call him Master, they call him Savior, or just Jesus, 'cause it's like a fragrance after the rain. Oh, Jesus, 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 let heaven and earth proclaim that kings, y'all hear me, and kingdoms, they will all pass away. But there's something about that name. And I got a few people to say the same with me. Say, Jesus. Call him Jesus. Say, Jesus. There is something about his name. I called him Master. Oh, yes, I have. I call him Savior. When I need him, I just say Jesus. It's like a beautiful fragrance. You ever smell that? Right after the rain. We're saying one more time, oh, Jesus, Jesus, it's Jesus. Oh, let the heavens and this earth proclaim. What fight is going on, or what war? All the kings and all the kingdoms, they're gonna pass away.
Work.
You
Remember when Moses died at the age of 120 and was buried on Mount Nebo, according to Deuteronomy chapter 34. God had already worked out the succession plan. He did that before he died. He says to Moses, Moses, take Hoshea, his original name, which is Joshua, take him out before the people. Put your hand on him. Right there before the people, and make sure that the spirit that is upon you will be parted with him. I want to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, succession plans are needed and necessary. But don't ever count God out. I had a fellow ask me not too long ago, what's your succession plan? I said, the same one they had when they called me. Depend on God. And is there anybody here that know God has a succession plan? And that succession plan always works when it's done God's way. The Bible says, my brothers and sisters, that it was Moses who changed Hoshea's name to Joshua. Joshua was not his given name. Hoshea was his given name. But Moses changed his name. The name, my brothers and sisters, Hoshea means salvation. The name Joshua means salvation is of the Lord. He changed his name right before he went in to spy out the land. Why? Glad you asked. He wanted to make sure that Joshua understood that it was nobody but the Lord. Every victory came because of the Lord. Every battle won came because of the Lord. Every success he had came because of the Lord. And may I drop this? I ain't gonna push it. I got too far to go. Can I drop this? Everything that you're successful in is because of nobody but the Lord. I wish I had somebody in here. I wish I had six people. I'd make seven to tell you. Nobody but the Lord. If you got a job, nobody but the Lord. If your rent is paid up, nobody but the Lord. If you got a little hoop and you're going around talking about $2, please, nobody but the Lord. If your children are doing wrong, all right, nobody but the Lord. If you got health and strength, nobody but the Lord. If you don't look like what you've been through, nobody but the Lord. He changes his name for purpose. Every time Joshua's name was called, it was a reminder, first of all, to Joshua. God did this. It was a reminder to the people, God did it. We're successful. We're victorious. In everything that we've done, especially the battles that we have won while we were in Canaan, nobody but the Lord has done it. Joshua would be his successor. Question is why? Glad you asked me. He was successful because the Spirit of the Lord was upon him. As a matter of fact, Joshua 33:9 says Joshua was full of the spirit of wisdom. Moses laid his hands on him, and the children of Israel hearkened unto him and did as the Lord commanded Moses. It was before Moses died that Moses was told to bring Joshua before the people, let them know that's the replacement. The Lord said unto Moses again, take him out there, put your hand on him, so that the people will know this is who you want to replace you. And not only you, this is the one that I want to replace you. The Bible says he did just as the Lord told him to do. Joshua was accepted, and the Lord was with Joshua. In all of his endeavors, the Lord was with him. In all of his engagements, the Lord was with him. In all of his exploits, the Lord was with him. And the people remained true to the Lord as long as the men of Joshua's generation lived. They were faithful to the Lord, and they were faithful to their leader as long as Joshua was alive. I want to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, as long as they had an impetus for being faithful to the Lord and their leader, they followed exactly what God wanted them to do. But the Bible says clearly, after Joshua died, the people went through a terrible your cycle. Rebellion. Repent. Ruin. Repentance. Restoration. A number of different cycles you will find on the pages of Holy Writ. They went through it over and over again. Rebellion. Ruin. Repentance. Restoration. God's mercy was upon them. And I need to tell you today that I thank God every day for the mercy of God. You know, you wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for the mercy of God. You wouldn't be sitting up in here this morning on a Sunday morning, on a fifth Sunday, if it wasn't for the Lord. You wouldn't have what you have if it wasn't for the mercy of God. Thank God his mercies are new every morning. I don't care what miserable situation you find yourself on a Saturday. On Sunday morning, his mercies are new. If you go through it on Monday, thank God Tuesday, his mercies are new. And somebody here ought to shout, thank you, Jesus. Praise his holy name. We serve a God whose mercies are new, not sometimes. They're new every morning. Same problem we have with the people today. They hear what they want to hear. I stand here on Sunday mornings and say some things, and by the time it get back around me, it's something totally different. I stand here Sunday after Sunday for 32 years, and I can say one thing, and some people will get it right, and invariably some people will show up and get it wrong. We'd play that little game that we used to play in elementary school, and some people still think it's a game. You say something to the person that had the head of the class, and he whispers to the next person, and they whisper to the next person. By the time it gets to the other side of the class, to the last person, and ask them, what did it say? It's told. Start out with it's a rainy day, and end up with the blue car. And some people still think it's a game. I wish I could preach like I did. My brothers and sisters, the Bible declares that the people literally did not want to hear what God said. When they got into that land flowing with milk and honey, according to Exodus 3 and 8, that land of plenty, that land of promise, that land of protection, the Bible declares that they just went crazy. They went crazy because they began to look at the things that were in the promised land that they didn't have when they were in Egypt, and not when they were in the wilderness wandering. They saw iron chariots. And they knew iron chariots were synonymous with Egypt, but this distance between Egypt and Canaan, it's been a long journey. They went to looking at houses that they didn't build. They went to looking at trees that they didn't plant. They went to looking at palm tree weather. They went to looking at trees that they didn't plant and finding yards that they didn't plant. And their mind, my brothers and sisters, began to think about all of the goodness of God, the greatness of God, the generosity of God. And they began to believe that all of the things that had been promised to them could not include the curses on it, that they would get blessings. Here's the problem. We think, yeah, we're blessed people, but don't you know God will let some things turn around in your life? If there ain't anybody here know that God will not open up doors and let you have success every now and then, he needs to put you in the university of hard knocks so that you will understand. If you make it out of it, I brought you, I kept you, I made a way for you. And I'm getting old enough now to thank God for not only the good, I'm thanking for the bad. Why? Glad you asked, because good plus bad plus God comes out good every time. It's divine arithmetic. Their problem was simple. That they began to forget what they should have. Look at Joshua, chapter 23, if you please. If you don't have your Bible, look on Amen. Turn around and tell your neighbor, Bible study, Bible study. Joshua 23, this is what he says, 23. Verse 1 says, and it came to pass a long time after that the Lord had given rest unto Israel from all their enemies. Round about that Joshua, he waxed old and stricken in age. Joshua called for all Israel and for the elders and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers and said unto them, I'm old and stricken in age. You've seen all that the Lord your God has done unto all these nations because of you. For the Lord your God, he is that has fought for you. Behold, I have divided unto you by lot these nations that remain to be an inheritance for your tribe, from Jordan with all the nations that I cut off, even unto the great sea westward. Lord your God, he shall expel them from before you and drive them from out of your sight. And ye shall possess their land as the Lord your God has promised unto you. Be therefore very courageous to keep and to do all that is written in the book of the law of Moses. That's the pivot, you know. That ye turn not aside therefore to the right hand or to the left. That ye come not among these nations that remain among you, neither make mention of the name of their gods. Don't speak their name. Nor cause to swear by them. Don't swear by their name. Neither serve them. Don't serve them. And bow yourselves unto them. In essence, he says unto them, don't speak their name. Don't swear unto their name. He says unto them, don't stoop to them. And don't serve them. And yet, they went the opposite way. He says unto them, but cleave unto the Lord your God, as you've done unto this day. For the Lord, it's the Lord that has driven out from before you great nations and strong. But as for you, no man has been able to stand before you unto this day. One man of you shall chase a thousand. One man of you shall chase a thousand. One man of you shall chase a thousand from the Lord your God. He is fighting for you. As he has promised you, take good heed therefore unto yourself that you love the Lord your God. Else if ye do it anywise, go back and cleave unto the remnant of these nations, even these that remain among you, and shall make marriage with them and go in unto them, and they to you. I know for certainty the Lord your God will no more, watch this, know for certainty that the Lord your God will no more drive out any of these nations from before you. But they shall be snares and traps unto you, scourges in your sides, thorns in your eyes, until ye perish from off this good land which the Lord your God has given you. And behold, this day I am going the way of all the earth, and ye know in all your hearts and all your souls, and not one thing has failed of all the good things the Lord has done. Therefore it shall come to pass that as all good things have come upon you which the Lord your God promised you, so shall the Lord bring upon you all evil things. So shall the Lord bring up you all evil things. So shall. I'm like them children. I'm conflicted. I'm afflicted on that one. So shall the Lord bring upon you all evil things. That's something to think about. That just as he will allow good things to come into your life, he will allow evil. Come here, Job. He couldn't be here this morning, but he told me to make this report. He will move the hedge around you so Satan can get to you and see whether or not your testimony is sure and strong as it is on Sunday. You're the one been running around here talking about nobody but the Lord, rolling under pews talking about nobody but the Lord, shouting, waving your hands, speaking in unknown tongues, talking about God, nobody but the Lord. And the Lord every now and then puts us in the university of hard knocks and said, for real? Lord, bring upon you all evil things until we have destroyed you from off this good land, which the Lord your God has given you. Verse 16 says, when ye have transgressed the covenant of the Lord, your God, which has commanded you, and have gone and served other gods, and bowed yourselves to them, then shall the anger of the Lord be kindled against you, and ye shall perish quickly from all the good land which he has given you. Isn't that what just happened? The children of Israel got into Canaan land and saw all of the things that were in Canaan. They began to serve other gods. They began to speak their names. They began to swear by them. They began to stoop to them. They began, my brothers and sisters, the Bible declares, they began to worship other gods. But God, in his mercy, sent deliverers, which are judges, to deliver them from their enemies. Because not only were they fighting people that were in Canaan, not only were they fighting enemies in Canaan, they were fighting people on the periphery of Canaan. They were fighting the Philistines. They were fighting the Moabites. They weren't just fighting the Canaanites. It's a whole lot of them people. I mean the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. I don't hear nobody. The Girgashites. They were fighting a whole lot of people. Because God unleashed the enemies upon them. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them. When we come down to the book of Judges, all we hear over and over again, the people are doing evil works. Evil. Over and over again, I wish you would, when you get home, we don't have time this morning, but I wish you would, over and over again, go through the book of Judges and see how many times it talks about how the people did evil. All God asked was for their love and their loyalty. All God asked for was for them to fear him. All God asked them to do is acknowledge me, appreciate me, and applaud me for my work among you. But the people of God began to do just what God told them not to do. But isn't that like people today? Now either I'm talking about you, I'm talking to you. And if I ain't talking about you, then you ought to just holler for the people that ain't here. You right, Reverend. They began to practice immorality. They began to practice intermarriage. They began to practice idolatry, intermingling, infidelity. That's just the name of few of the sins that they were guilty of. They forgot God. In the midst of all God had done, they forgot God. But God, in his mercy, sent deliverers. They've seen themselves go from a glorious conquest into gradual compromise with grim consequences. God says to them in Exodus 4, he said, I will no longer protect you. And God performs just what he promises. He allowed the Philistines and the Moabites to come upon them. And many of them began to serve their enemies. Again, the people of God felt like the peace and prosperity they were experiencing in times of rest was God's sign of his favor. All of those promises that God had made to their forefathers in Deuteronomy chapter 28, and all of the blessings that were there, that they would only experience the blessing, but they would, yeah, it was more verses about curses than it was blessings. I think 1 through 14 is about blessings, but 15 through about 68 is about curses. Try that one out on your side of town. Generationally, they were declining. They did evil. 3 and 7, they did evil. 3 and 12, they did evil. 4 and 1, they did evil. 6 and 1, they did evil. 6 and 25, they did evil. 8 and 33, they did evil. 10 and 6, they did evil. 13 and 1, they did evil. Stop, rewind, play that again. 3 and 7, they did evil. 3 and 12, they did evil. 4 and 1, they did evil. 6 and 1, they did evil. 6 and 25, they did evil. 8 and 33, they did evil. 10 and 6, they did evil. 13 and 1, they did evil. Do you know what they're doing? That's what I've been trying to tell you. As a matter of fact, to sum it all up and to give us possibly the key verse of the book of Judges, Judges 17 and 6. In those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyesight. Everyone did that which was right in his own eyesight. And so the Lord allowed 7 nations to come upon them. With all of this chaos, with all of this destruction of them, the other nations coming upon them, they had a choice to make. It's going to be regeneration by following your judges, or be degeneration by following your own plans. Israel's unfaithfulness is about to come back to them. The Lord raises up judges. Othniel, God raised him up. Judges 3 and 9, that's Caleb's younger brother. He led the people against the king of Mesopotamia, Cush and Rishathaim. Then next there came in 3, the next verse, Ehud, as that left-handed prophet, put a knife in with eye on this room. I don't hear nobody. Took that little dagger and stuck it in the very belly of Eglon. The Bible says that he was so fat. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. That when he stabbed him, the fat covered the handle of the dagger as well the blade. And here's what that last verse said, and the dirt came out. That would be enough for me to preach right there. Because you do know dirt will. See, I told y'all. It will come out. Ehud, that left-handed prophet. I call it lefty killed hefty. But when we come down to this one verse, what can a man get out of one verse? What? Reverend, you ain't got nothing to work with. Oh, it's one verse. And I have great challenge in one verse preaching. But what's in this verse that might help us and we leave this place better than when we arrive? He's Shamgar. His name is Shamgar. He rises out of the mist as the third judge given to Israel. He's not assigned a tribe as the other ones have. He may be included because he brings the number of tribes to 12, which represents the 12 tribes of Israel. Shamgar. The third judge on the pages of Holy Writ is seemingly a farmer or herdsman. He's only mentioned in Judges 3 and 31 and Judges 5 and 6. He strikes a mighty single-handed blow for the Lord and then steps off of the stage as quickly as he stepped on it. He plays a major part in the history of Israel. His name means stranger. Not a whole lot is given about him here. There's nothing but one verse, but it's packed with preaching possibility. He's a national hero, but he don't get but one verse. It might be indicative of the fact that too many of us want too much pull. The rest of them got a whole lot of verses, but Shamgar only gets one verse. But I tell you, if you just look at it, after him, talking about Ehud, was Shamgar, the son of Ehud, which slew the Philistines 600 men with an ox going. And he also delivered Israel. That's not much of a resume. At the age when we want our resume filled with a whole lot of stuff, that ain't much of a resume. He's the son of a man. He slew of the Philistines 600 men, and he did it with an ox goad. That ain't much. But you know what it teaches us? It teaches us to use what we got. It teaches that you may not have much, but you ought to use what you have. Let me say, when you look at Judges chapter 5, verse 6 through 8, that gives us another glimpse of it, gives us a little background of this verse. The children of Israel at the time of Shamgar have been having it rough. Things are not good for the people of God. Things are deplorable, as a matter of fact. He comes on the scene when Jabin is king of Canaan, and Jabin had 900 chariots of iron. The mere mention of Jabin's name would scare the people of God. I suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, it just must have happened that Shamgar got tired of his nation being overrun by enemies. And he decided to do something some people won't do. He decided, I'm going to use what I have and I'm going to stand up today against my enemies. And against the enemies of God, out of fear, the people could hardly go on with life as usual. And Shamgar decided, I got to do something. Othel's leadership had brought 40 years. Ehud's leadership had brought 80 years. Ain't nothing about here about how much peace they had after Shamgar. But thank God, Shamgar picked up that little ox goad. There's the man, but there's the means. An ox goad. An instrument with a pointed end to prod oxen. Again, that's a great example of how God can use anyone who is willing to take what they have. Did they take a jawbone of an ass in Samson's hand? Turn around and tell your neighbor, Reverend Cuss, Reverend Cuss. Did he take a little needle and some cloth and some thread in the hands of Dorcas? Did he take a little lad's lunch, not a man's lunch, but a lad's lunch, two fish, five barley loaves? W.T. Glenn says it was more like two sardines and five little biscuits. In essence, whatever you have, if you'll put it to use for God, God will make it come out more. Those of us who follow God closely and are willing to be used of him are more than conquerors, because he gives us strength. He gives us strength equal and sufficient for every task to help us overcome the evils and wickedness of the world. Shamgar repelled the Philistines. The Philistines. Remember? The lion, that great giant, was from Gath. And had some brothers. That's one of the very reasons for it that David picked up more than one stone. Just in case the homeboy showed up. So I'm gonna fail this big giant. Fool around y'all, come on here. I'll do the same thing to y'all that I did to him. Against you, God is still able. I don't know whether he killed all 600, some level at one time. I can't tell you how he did it. All I know is that Holy Writ is true. One man killed 600 for this deed. And here we are at Rock of Ages Baptist Church on a Sunday morning still talking about it.
Just remain faithful.
You are sure of this, Isaiah 54:17, no weapon formed against you. I be hollering right now. Shall prosper. Don't be afraid of the arrows and the snares by night. Don't do it. You about to push me there. No weapon formed against you. Here's what it doesn't say. It doesn't say that a weapon won't form. Folk gonna make sure of that. But it just won't cost. Hallelujah, Lord. Now, as I pray for you, tune in next Sunday. Same time. Same place. Same bat station. Here it is. What has God given you to help wage war with the enemy? Be it big or small, God can use it. And there are a whole lot of people that have a lot of gifts, a lot of talents, a lot of things to offer in the service of the Lord, but fear causes them to sit on the sidelines. All of our churches could be better up and running a little better. But sideline critics who never get in the game, always complaining on the bench. You know, if it was me, I'd have shot a three-pointer. You know, if it was me, I would have run left instead of right. That's bitch talk. Get in the game. You might not get much publicity, but at the end of the day, God will get out of your service something that will lead men, women, boys, and girls to Him. Turn around and tell your neighbor, he said he was closing. But I didn't say it three times. Two and a half. Thank you, buddy. How many of you here this morning have what seemingly seems so little? So little. How many here this morning have what it seems to be almost nothing to offer? You don't have a lot of money. What happens when you start talking in that terms? That probably stops about 90% of us. Oh, I'm sorry, I said us, I'm sorry. From getting involved. Because you can't see yourself working with what God gave you. It just seems so little. But with just what you have, just give it. Next time when you go into a store where they're selling puzzles, always remember that if they leave one piece of the puzzle out, it's an incomplete puzzle. And 500 piece puzzle, 499 pieces in there, and one missing piece is not a complete puzzle. Nothing will be complete around here until you get it. And you get it, Lord, regardless of what it seemed like. And let me say to those who feel like, well, child, I didn't try to get, I heard it. I didn't try to get involved and act like they don't want me involved. Try again. Try again. Try again. Try again. Ain't nobody gonna let you take over. I'm gonna put that out there free too. We're trying. But it's just so small. Remember, I got all the writers, and I can't do much. I got it too. My mama had it. I think she gave it to me. Grandma, I can't see. That's why my font is going up to 24. Grandma, I can't talk either, child. Every now and then I'll kill the king's English. But I told the Lord, if you can use this feeble body of mine. I can't remember, child, I can't even. If you use this feeble body of mine, turn it around for your glory. I want to open up the doors of the church. Maybe there's someone here today that has not given their life to the Lord yet. Don't die and go downstairs. Don't die and go to the smoking section.
All right, sir.
This may be your last time. This may be your only time. This may be all you got. And really, honestly, I wouldn't sit in the pew and let the Lord have to fight me, get me up. After all he's done for you just this week. I'm not talking about all your life. I'm talking about just this week. If I was you, I'd just come right now. Without a lot of fanfare, I'd just come. Tell that person next to you, baby, I think I'm going right now. I think I'm going to take my pocketbook with me, but I'm going right now. You come right now.
Amen.
What are you waiting on? Why are you standing on the sideline? The doors are open. Come on, daughter.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper.
The doors are open. Today that don't have much, whatever we got, we're gonna put it to work for your kingdom business and kingdom building. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being a merciful God. Thank you that your mercies are new every morning. Every morning they are new. Like clockwork. Just as soon as we get up on another morning, mercies are staring us in the face. New mercies. We ask right now that you would bless your people. Show them where they can be used in your service. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Lord is good. He's worthy of all of our praises. Hallelujah. We're making our way through the book of Judges as we look at every judge. We come to Samson's ear, his fleece, and his fight. See how the Lord works through him and through Deborah and Barak. I told you on the other week, that's not Barack Obama. It's not this that other Barack. Amen. And it is the pastor's prayer as we go down through the book of Judges. We will come out with a clearer understanding of how God works in marvelous ways to defend us and to defeat our enemies. Amen. Him good? Try that book. I'll have him good. Didn't that make you feel good? Amen. I know. I'm very aware. We have a number of people who are very, very, very scholarly. But him good. So we do. Let me thank you, those of you who have given this month, this Clergy Appreciation Month. And many of you have been over and done over and above. I want to thank you as a congregation. The Clergy Appreciation Month is done under the umbrella of the Shepherd's Ministry. Amen. Hallelujah. And I want to just say thank you. Mama said that when anybody do anything good for your boy, you need to tell them thank you. And every now and then she leave a little water at the pump to cry. That's what she say. And I knew automatically, thank you belongs somewhere in the vicinity. Amen. Hallelujah. So thank you for what you've done. Let me give you these announcements, and you be mindful of them. Barbara Pye's father passed. Ellen Mayberry passed. The mother, Felicia Mayberry. Kathy Henderson's mother passed. Jesse Matlock passed. Marquita Barnes' brother passed last night. Amen. Emma Smith is in Meadowbrook Manor Rehab. Johnny Pitts is in Rush Presbyterian Hospital. Sigrid Shuddy and Irma England, Shirley Kelly, Sylvia Block. And then let me also announce the Fall Revival, Monday, November 13th, and Wednesday, November 15th, 7 p.m. nightly. Pastor Tolan J. Morgan, you already know that man without that man that got that other Bible. He'll be here. Amen. Pastor Fellowship Bible Baptist Church in Warner Robins, Georgia. Amen. I want to make sure that all of us are here, all of us in place. I guarantee you we ain't going to be here all night. Turn around and tell your neighbor, they don't be up in there all night. Some of y'all said that come this or not. I be saying stuff to just check y'all out sometimes. Some of y'all want to shake it, yeah, I ain't going to be up in there all night. Sure that we're knowledgeable of that. Amen. 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 What time is it? Offering. gave it to you. Amen. Amen.
It's offering time. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on, let's celebrate our pastor.
Amen.
Jesus, God, we come saying thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, thank you for what's about to be given in this place. We ask that you are allowed to be given for kingdom building and kingdom business. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand the ushers at this time.
Say.
Jesus, God. We've come just to say thank you. Lord, thank you for this Sunday morning, oh God. Lord, thank you for your word that's went forth in this place. Now, Lord, we ask right now, God, that you bless us all as only you know how. Lord, we ask that you dismiss us from this place, but never from your presence. Now, Lord, lead us to our various destinations. Lord, we know that you're able to do it. Now, may the grace of God, the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, rest, rule in the Bible that's henceforth and forevermore. And the children of God say, amen.